Hello students, welcome to session 3 of chapter number 2, class 12, computer science.
Okay students, so we'll be starting with tuples now. So what are tuples? First of all, they're the collection of similar or dissimilar type of data elements that are enclosed within parentheses. So this is the example of a tuple, okay. The contents over here can be of the similar data elements or they can be of dissimilar type, as you can see over here. Now, tuples are immutable by nature, okay? They are not modifiable objects. They are non-modifiable objects. We cannot modify the contents of the tuple at their place, okay? Like we have done it in the list. Now, how to create tuples? First of all, you see, this is how we are creating empty tuples. T equals to just empty parenthesis sign we have used here. Similarly, T1 equals to we have used here tuple method or the constructor for tuple, which is actually going to return an empty tuple within T1. Now you can see here T2 is again a tuple which carries some values inside it. Okay, these are the data elements of the tuple. Now we come to nested tuples. As you have done about the nested list, as you've learned about the nested list, same is the case with nested tuples also. Okay, singleton tuple, if we just want one element inside the tuple, how to write that element? Like T is the tuple object equals to 1 comma, we have to put a comma here, okay, or we can also write it as T equals to 1 comma. This is going to create a singleton tuple or tuple with just single element. Like if we just write T equals to 1 without using a comma, what will happen? If we are just we will just print the type of T, okay, so this is going to give us that T is of type int. So that means this, without using comma, is an integer. It will be treated as an integer rather than as a tuple. Now next we come to when we have to convert our string into tuple, okay, so we are using here tuple method, okay, and the string is inside, and now what will happen, this is going to return a tuple within T1 object. T1 is going to point at or refer to at this tuple object, sorry, T1 is the tuple object which is going to point at this data elements. Then we have, like over here, we want to convert a list into tuple, so we have just passed the list as the parameter or the list object as the parameter in the tuple method. So this is again going to convert it in the tuple form. Okay. Similarly, we can also use the eval function. It will just work as it is. It has worked with list. Just the user has inputted the elements in parentheses sign rather than in square brackets, as we have done it in lists. Now, so there are so many similarities between tuples and lists, okay, like tuples also support forward and backward indexing, slicing and indexing is just similar as we have done in lists. Similarly, we can use length function to find the length of the tuple. Concatenation and replication operators or membership operators, comparison operators works just like as we have worked with list, okay. But the major difference between a list and a tuple is that lists are mutable and tuples are immutable objects. Like we can see over here one example, L is the list object, T is the tuple object here. I want to change the element at index 2 in the list, okay. This is valid, the value will be changed here. You can see over here the at L2, previously it was 3, now it has changed to 9. Whereas if I want to change the value of a tuple at some position, we'll not be able to do that. Okay. It is invalid. Next we come to unpacking of tuples. See, when we are creating a tuple, okay, at that time we'll say that we are packing a tuple, okay, we are creating a tuple or packing a tuple. But if we want the tuple elements to be separated out in various variables, okay, so at that time we say that we are unpacking a tuple. Like we can see over here, we have a tuple t, right? And now I want that this how many elements are there? 1, 2, 3, 4. So we require 4 variables here to unpack my tuple. So WXYZ equals to T. That means what? That the zeroth element at the zeroth position will go to W. Element at first position will go to X. Similarly, the rest of the elements will be assigned to the respective variables. Okay. Now, what built-in functions we can use with tuples? So these are the common functions as we have done it with list. Same is the case with tuples. We can use length function, max, minimum to find the maximum and minimum values within the tuple. We can count a number, how many times the number has appeared inside the tuple. That will be done with count method. Okay. Then we can use del statement. See, del statement in list can delete a particular element from the list, because lists are actually mutable. We can make changes into the list. We can actually edit our lists, but we cannot edit our tuples. Okay, so we cannot delete an individual element or a set of elements from the tuple. Rather, we if we want to delete the whole tuple itself, then we can use del statement here. Okay, del t is correct. Whereas if I want to delete the first element, that means the element placed at index 1, that will give me an error over here. Similarly, if I want to find the index of the occurrence of the some element, first occurrence of some element, that is also possible here. Like t dot index 2, so 2 actually has come at index number 1 here, right? Modifying elements of a tuple. So how to modify the elements? I've told you that it is immutable object. Okay. Now, if I want to modify my tuple elements, then I have two methods over here. First one is, first of all, I unpack the tuple elements as I've done it over here. Okay. Then I can modify them. Let's suppose I want to make x as 9. So I can write x equals to 9, and then again I can pack them t equals to WXYZ. Okay. So this is how I can pack my tuple again, and this is how I can modify it. Other method is, I can convert my tuple to first of all in the list form using list method. Then I can modify my list, and then finally I'll convert it to the tuple again using tuple method. This will do when we'll be learning about the programming. Okay, now we come to dictionaries. So first of all, as you all know, what is a dictionary? Dictionary is actually a collection of key value pair enclosed in curly braces. So just like in dictionary, what happens? Key value pair, I have told. In dictionaries, what do we do? If we want to search for for the meaning of some word, so I should know the word, and then I will try to find out the meaning of that word. So similarly, if I am storing my elements in the form of dictionary, so I'll not actually locate them using indexes. Rather, I'm going to locate them or call them with their keys. Okay, so like in a directory, what happens? Do you actually find the phone number of a person with the help of indexes? Like at index 0, this is the phone number. At index 1, this is the phone number. No, actually, you first of all, you should know the name of that person whose phone number you are trying to find out. And this is how when we search for the name of that person and the respective phone number. So similarly, in dictionaries also, this also works the same way. It is working as key value pair. Okay, so first thing is, they are mutable. Okay, they are mutable. That means we can change their values at place. Okay, as well as they are unordered collection. We cannot say this element is at location 0, this element is at location 1. Okay, and so on, like we are doing with lists and tuples. Okay, so these are unordered collections. Okay. Now, dictionaries are indexed on the basis of keys only. Okay. We don't have an index number. Rather, we refer our dictionary elements with the help of keys only. Now, how to create a dictionary? This is how we create empty dictionaries. We have dict method to create an empty dictionary here. Now, how to write the dictionary elements? Like dict 1 I have used here. Now, this is my key. Anjali is the key. First is the key and separated by a colon, and then comes the value of that key. Okay. Mukesh will be the key and geography will be the value. Sabha will be the key and history will be the value. Key and values are always separated with a colon. First of all, we write key and then use a colon and then its value. Like this. Okay. Now, you can see here, I've just told that these are the keys and these are the values. Now, when we are naming a key, what things should be in our mind? We should watch the things we should keep in our mind. See, keys are always immutable data types. So that means we cannot use a dictionary, we cannot use a list as a key. Okay, so they should be immutable data types. They can be integers, they can be strings, tuples that contains immutable elements. Okay, so the keys should have this characteristics. Now, how to access elements of a dictionary? Like over here, you can see dictionary 1, Anjali teaches English. Okay, that means what? I'll just write the key over here. Dict 1. And here I'll mention the key and it is going to return me what? It will return me the value of that key that is associated with that key. Okay. Now, if I want to see all the keys of my dictionary, so I'll just use my keys method. Dict1.keys. It is going to return all the keys that I've used here. Similarly, dict1.values is going to return me all the values that are present within the dictionary. Now, one very important thing is keys must be unique. Okay, we cannot use two same keys for different values. But other way around, it is possible. That means we can use two similar values for different keys. Okay, adding elements to a dictionary. If we just want to add some more elements to my dictionary, what I'll do? I'll just write dict 1 and then I'll give the key over here. Dict 1, this is the key and this is the value. Okay, so dict 1 key equals to whatever the value is. This is how I will enter or add another data element to my dictionary here. Okay, like over here, Piyush is added. You can see that Piyush is added here in your dictionary. Okay, updating a dictionary element, if I want to update some element in the dictionary, so what I'll do, I'll just use the key over here and change the value. Like over here, data is my dictionary which contains x as 10, y as 15 and z as 20. So data z equals to 25 will change my value of z. Okay, if I want to delete a dictionary element, what I'll do, I'll just use del statement here. Del, data and z. Okay, whatever the key is. So that key along with its value will be deleted. Okay, now I can also delete my data element using pop method. Pop method also deletes the key value pair, but it returns the corresponding value that has been deleted. Okay, which del function, del statement is not doing. Like you can see here, employ, these are the key value pairs over here. If I say employ.pop age, okay, so age has the value 35, so 35 will be returned also here. Okay, employ.pop debt not found. So if I am actually trying to delete or popping up any key which is not present in some dictionary, in that dictionary, so either it is going to give me a key error because that key is actually not present, or otherwise if I'll try to write a message over here. I want to pop up a message. If that key is not present, I want to pop up a message not found. So it is not going to give me an error, rather it will just show not found, whatever message I have written here. Okay, so students, this is the end of this session. We'll meet you in the next session. Thank you so much.